Welcome back to the Learn Wgpu tutorial series. This is going to be about depth buffers. Now, this setup that we have going on, the rendering, is basically a 10 by 10 set of the pentagons that we've been rendering. But if I zoom in here and we look to the right, if I do this correctly, so right here in the second row, you can see that the last item in this row, or I don't know if it's the last item, this item here, we'll call it like item number 7 or whatever, overlays item number 6, which is technically in front of it. So to fix this kind of like Z index ordering issue, because of course when it comes down to it, these aren't overlapping at all. So something that is on the right should not be rendering in front of something that is on the left, like this is right here. So to fix this, we can basically create a render pass that creates a depth buffer. And the depth buffer is not really a misnomer, but if you've never heard the words depth buffer before, think of this as a 2D texture that is in black and white that tells us the Z index, so the index like from the camera, the layering of every pixel that we are rendering to the screen. And then we can use that depth buffer to be able to tell which pixel we should be rendering here. So the tutorial mentions that there are two ways to solve this. One of them is sort the data from back to front, so that we are always rendering things that are in front last, which means that they, like the effect that we just saw, will render in front of anything that we render first. And then the second option is the depth buffer, which we'll be going over today. So first of all, the back to front methodology is something that's kind of good for 2D. So if you have like a 2D parallax, for example, you might have a bunch of layers going from back to front that move at different rates. And rendering the ones that are closer to the camera last places them over the ones that are further away. And that works really well because they're just a bunch of layers going back. This gets tougher in 3D rendering because the objects change based on the camera rotation, and objects can not only render in front of other things, but they can render in front of themselves. So a depth buffer then is a black and white texture, so a 2D like image, like a PNG, that stores the Z coordinate of rendered pixels. So it stores how far the pixel that we rendered is from the camera. And you can think of this more like it stores the Z index of how far the model is or whatever from the camera. And we can then, as we render our scene, use this information to tell whether something should be rendered in front of something else by doing a comparison between these Z indexes. So in texture.rs, I'm just going to drop in this code right at the top of our impl texture, and then I'm going to delete the last curly brace. And that should give us all of the code that we need where we need it. So we still have all the old code like from image and from bytes and things like that, but we also created this new create depth texture function. There's a const here where we specify the format of the depth texture. In this case, it's a depth 32 float or an F32. So we're using an F32 to store the Z index information. The depth texture itself, because we're rendering to say something that our screen size, right? Like a full 16:9, 4K, whatever. The black and white texture that we create to be the depth texture needs to be the same size. You could imagine that if this texture was say smaller, we might pick a pixel on it in the wrong spot and get a weird result. So an extent 3D is how we describe the size of the thing that we're going to be rendering to. As has been sort of the methodology in older videos and older sections of this tutorial, we use the descriptor pattern for a texture descriptor struct. We can specify the label, the size, the MIP level count, which we still haven't gone over, so don't be worried if you don't know what that is, the sample count, the dimension, so this is a 2D image, so it's like just like a PNG. There are texture dimensions that can go either single dimensional or three dimensional, but we're only working with two dimensional textures today. The depth format is that F32 format that we talked about earlier. And then because we are going to render to this image, like we're going to use this as an output, we need to use the render attachment texture usages, flag basically. Then we also use the flag to allow us to bind this texture. Using our device or using our GPU, we need to create the texture using that descriptor. And then we also need to create the view of that texture. So in shaders and things like that, we don't really ever access these textures directly. We use samplers. And the way that we look at these textures and the way that we sample into them can be changed and configured. So that's what we're doing here. When we create our view and we create our sampler, we use the descriptor pattern once again. In this case, we're using a couple of different address modes for the U, V, and W coordinates, which are the same coordinate concepts as X, Y, Z. So you can think of these as X, Y, Z if you don't feel that comfortable with U, V, W. And this specifies what happens to this texture if we happen to sample something that is outside of the texture size. So if we've got a 4K image and we sample something at 6,230 or whatever, this specifies what kind of value we will get. Now, in the tutorial, this is an interesting point because they reference needing to use the less equal compare function due to the way that GLSL works. We aren't using GLSL, we're using WGSL. So keep an eye out for that if you see results that don't quite make sense. And then, of course, we return our texture, the view into the texture, and the sampler. We need to drop some code in that uses the device, so we have to go down at least until the device has been created. I believe we also need config. Yeah, we need device and config for the arguments here, so we need at least device available, but also config. And config is down here for us on line 299. You might have it on a different line number, depending on how you went through the tutorial and where you wrote your code. That's totally fine, don't worry about it. So inside of the texture struct that we just created, the associated function create depth texture exists because we just created it. This takes the GPU device and the config, which specifies things like the window size, and then we label this as depth texture. So this gets passed into the label as a string. And that gives us depth texture as a variable. Down in the render pipeline, where we're creating the render pipeline, we have to scroll down a little bit to depth stencil. Depth stencil is the thing that we are going to work with now that we actually have not been using at all, which is why we're seeing these issues in our rendering. So the depth stencil then takes a depth stencil state. The format uses that texture format that we had before, the F32. The depth compare function is the really important part here. This function tells us when to discard a new pixel based on the value in our depth texture. The less compare function will mean that pixels are drawn front to back, and of course we will be writing to it, so we need to enable depth write. The depth texture and the stencil texture are commonly stored in the exact same texture or the same buffer. We aren't using this value, and also the Learn WGPU tutorial series doesn't have a tutorial for stencil this time. But if you've ever seen Townscaper and you've seen the windows for the buildings inside of Townscaper, I believe that is achieved via a stencil texture. So stencils allow you to kind of push geometry in without actually rendering additional geometry to push a window in. And of course, down at the bottom, we need to have our depth texture in the return value for state. Note that we have not yet, and I don't think the tutorial has told us to, but we haven't yet added this to the state. So up in struct state, there is no depth texture here. Inside of resize, I'm going to take self.depth texture. And right after we update config with the new sizes, we're going to set the depth texture. Now, the tutorial mentions that we need to set this after we update config. So I don't know if they mean here updating config by doing self.config.whatever, or if they mean updating the surface. I think they mean updating the surface. So we're going to put this on line 484 and see if it does what we want it to do. But this, of course, is the same function that we created earlier, the create depth texture function on our texture. And we're just setting that equal to something that uses the same device, the same config, the same label that we were using before. And then inside of the render function in our render pass, you can see that we have a depth stencil attachment here that is set to none, so we're not using it. We're going to end up using that. So the depth stencil attachment is going to be a render pass depth stencil attachment struct with the view for the depth texture, the depth operations, and the stencil ops. We aren't using a stencil, so stencil is still none. So the one thing that's really interesting is that the tutorial never actually tells you to put this into the state. So this depth texture is something that we have to go put in state ourselves. And I'm going to type that as texture for now, because that is the return value of the create depth texture function. So not too big of a deal. And then we can run our code, and let's make this larger. And we can see now that right here on our right-hand side, this is no longer producing artifacts that have things that should be behind other things in front of objects they should be behind, which is great. And I can't even find the one we were looking at specifically anymore. Oh, well. Oh, there it is. Right here. So this one right here on this corner would have been the one that was rendering in front. And now it's rendering behind because of that depth texture. So everything looks good to me. And that is what a depth texture is. And you'll notice that we never actually sampled it ourselves or never used it ourselves. We can use this ourselves in our shader to do really interesting effects. But the sort of the support that WGPU gives us already to make use of a depth texture or depth buffer is what's doing this or z-index, whether we keep a pixel or not, determination. So we didn't actually have to write shader code today. We didn't actually have to use this thing ourselves. We just had to create it and put it in our structs in the right places. So I hope you enjoyed this semi-shorter Learn WGPU adventure. And the next one will be model loading. So look forward to that, because getting models from like Blender or something into your GPU programs makes a lot of sense if you want to display 3D objects. And I hope you enjoyed this video. I will see you in the next one. Have a great day.